we are not definitely a power company. We are not even a solar company. We are an energy solutions company. There is no big number that we are really chasing. What we are chasing is that good quality customers should be converting to solar. When people understand this technology and the benefits of it, the adoption will increase. Solar is becoming democratized and people can use it even their smallest form. I think a very interesting question, because you know, as a company, we always wanted to work with the customers directly. So that is one part of it. The other part is, I think when you look at the solar generally, instead of a rooftop versus a utility scale, the challenges in a country like ours is about the land, the transmission, and at the end of it, payment capability of our distribution company. So these are the three factors which, in my opinion, make rooftop solar much more comfortable or much more convenient for us to adopt as a country, rather than trying to do very large scale solar power plants, because the land challenges are significant. Because for every 1 megawatt of solar plant, you need like 3 acres. And when we are trying to set up thousands of megawatts, that type of land is not available. And we are blocking that land for next 25 years, 30 years. Yeah, I think that there is significant progress, both in terms of the adoption, because there were, as I talked earlier, is about the early adoption. There were some early adapters. Like in any technological space, there will be some early adapters who will start using it in the initial stages, even though the technology may be expensive, but as the technology matures, the cost decreases. There are more and more people who start following it up. So like when we started like 5 years back, we set up our first plant of 100 kilowatt. Now we are close to say 350 megawatt. The number of customers, from one customer to having 100 plus customers, it has created a sort of a buzz in the market that this is something which people are going for and people want to adopt. I think any knowledgeable customer, and we want to work only with knowledgeable customers, they do their research properly. They will have their own technology department, they will have their own commercial department. So they will actually go around looking for who the suppliers are, who are the credible suppliers, who can actually provide us the support for next 25 years, who are the people who can actually finance it from their own money, from borrowed money, etc. Who are the people who can maintain it. People do all the research before they take the final decision for procuring it. Customers think hard about it because they have options. Right? So we are not the only one who do that. So now the customers have to do a comparison with different companies who offer the similar model. And now that's where the differentiation will come. What is the quality you're offering? What is the safety aspect you provide? What are your operation maintenance? How fast you can do it? How properly you can do it? These are some of those factors which become actually the differentiators. So people have to do that analysis, and we actually encourage customers that you should be knowing what you are getting into. It will be a difficult sell, of course, because if you are giving people like 5% benefit, people will think, okay, this is my roof is getting blocked for 25 years, should I really go for it? What happens if it really doesn't work? But if it's a 30-40% benefit and other people have done it, then it becomes obviously an easier buy. But having said that, whatever discount you give to the customers is never enough. So people always look for a better deal. We provide a model where we actually invest the capital. So this is called the OPEX or the PPA model, where we are investing the capital. So when we look at our own ROI, from a customer perspective, there is no investment. So the return on investment is infinite, if you really look at it, because you're just saving. But if you look from our perspective, we obviously have to make a reasonable estimate of what our cost of capital is, what our cost of equity is, then provide that tariff, which typically ranges around 6 to 8 years. In the early stages, it was like a new industry. Mm-hmm. So banks didn't really understand how a rooftop is different from a utility scale. So from bank's perspective, like solar plant versus a solar plant, and this is much smaller solar plant. So in terms of the effort required for a bank to evaluate such a small plant was probably not commensurate enough to the money that they were going to make on that project. So that was one of the challenges. Then I think with the introduction of the World Bank assisted line, which went to SBI, and the ADB line, which went to PNB, the markets have become a little easier because banks got a cheaper line of funding and they were able to recover enough money to put in the efforts. And we call ourselves as a low carbon, energy efficient solutions. So what can be that solution? Today it may be all around solar, it may be tomorrow about the batteries and the storage, because that will become an integral part of thing. Then we may be moving into electric vehicles, into the integration of all these things. Essentially anything which is low carbon and touches the lives of the customers on almost daily basis, that becomes our solution space. When you look at the younger workforce, obviously people are much more clued on to what's happening across the world, and the global warming and the renewable energy, etc., are something which are more talked about topics nowadays, and people want to really do that. Like, for example, we get students as young as in like class 11, class 12, who want to do some sort of a small project with us because this is where they can relate to. Here the technology is much simpler, the solar technology is much simpler. There can be much shorter time frame required for training these people. So people can be trained right from 1 month to 6 months, and they can actually start doing a decent construction job of it. Similarly, people can do an operation maintenance job in this aspect. But what's happening is, particularly in our space, because we do so many small plants, the rooftop plants, the employment generation is much higher. At the rooftop generation, it's very, very small, because like if you look at the country's installed capacity, something like 350,000 megawatt, out of that we continuously generate some 175,000 megawatt. Even if we set up 20,000 megawatt of rooftop, which is today 2,000, is 20,000 is going to generate only 4,000 megawatt worth of electricity, because the PLF is 20%. And when you compare that with like 175,000 megawatt of energy being consumed, it's not even 2%. So what are we really fighting for? We have to commercially incentivize those people. Essentially what's happening is, distribution company is losing money, then why will they promote it? Never. So it's not in their interest. It may be in the interest of some of the policy makers, some of the politicians, some of the regulators, that I want to promote renewable energy. So that is one way of doing it. But if it commercially hurts you, then you find out five other ways to stop it. So that is where we have to commercially align them and say that even if somebody is going to set up a rooftop, you're also going to make some money out of it. I think the energy is not only about the solar rooftop. Buildings can also be very energy efficient. So one has to look at in a holistic manner that how do we make this energy, both the demand side and supply side, much more renewable focused and much more efficient. So I think what I expect is that there will be much faster adoption on the rooftop solar, particularly in the residential segment, because people are getting curious, people are getting inquisitive about what is this all about and how can I save money out of this. So this is something which government has to seriously think about, to remove the impediments in adoption of rooftop solar in the residential segment. The second thing, I think there will be a storage, the battery storage will start becoming more common, and then you will start seeing an integration of the solar or the renewable energy with the battery storage. And the third thing I think is, there is going to be a much faster adoption of the electric vehicles than what we have been thinking till now. And that is going to integrate a lot of the storage, the renewable energy generation, and the electric vehicles. So it becomes a complete ecosystem by itself. I would say the pricing and the quality both, I would say, we are lacking by around 5 to 10%. Safeguard duty will increase the prices in China for the equipment that are coming from China and Malaysia. But I'm not sure this is going to be definitely helpful for the Indian manufacturers, because what will also happen is that the Chinese manufacturer will also find out ways to reduce the prices. So whether Indian companies will be making money because of the safeguard duty, that's a question. Government has to continue to drive the sector, because the biggest demand is coming from the government side, particularly the distribution company side. Unless the government decides and saying that I'm completely freeing up this sector and I'm going to let people set up the plant. If they're able to sell in the open market, that's fine. But I don't think that's going to happen. So the larger demand will continue to be driven out of the government tenders. What we only believe will be good for the economy and for the consumers in general is that the government can become more like a facilitator, particularly in the distributed solar space. I think the coal or the fossil fuel will need to remain there because that is like the base load plant. Till we get a viable solution where you can literally store whatever energy you require from the renewable sources and use it when the renewable sources are not available. And I think that day is very, very far off. That's not like in the near, immediate or even medium term future. That's not going to happen. So there is going to be a requirement of dependence on either the fossil fuel or the nuclear power.